103 FM.
Okay, so all clear right here, and with a green light from my production team, we hand you over to Dr. Albert Agbesi Wanyo and then Mr. Isaac Nsoa Akwabo is coming from the Department of Communication and Media Studies, University of Education, Winneba. Remember, the radio lecture happened to be having the topic Academic Discourse 1, and for all over 100 students of our prestigious University of Education, Winneba, studying the course GPDR 111. Communication skills. So without much ado, I say good morning to you, our lecturers, and you're welcome to the studios.
Thank you very much. And our dear listeners and our dear students, especially level 100 students, the freshers, you are all welcome. You are warmly welcome to our radio lecture series. And this morning, we're going to start with our radio lectures. And in the studio this morning, your lecturers, Dr. Albert Agbesi Wanyo, with my colleague
Isaac Kwajo Nsonwa Akwa.
Yes, so we are here this morning for the Communication Skills Radio Lecture Series. So once again, you are welcome. And as my studio boss here, Mr. Fuga, used to say, call a friend to call a friend to call a friend. Is that it?
Exactly.
All right. So call a friend to call a friend to tune in to Radio Windy Bay, your only station on campus. Great. Now, let me start with the course. GPDR 111, that is the course code, and the course title is Communication Skills. And most often students ask, communication skills, why should we offer this course? What is it about? So we're going to start this morning with the broad aim of this course. What is the purpose of this course? Why do you have to offer this course? And what will the course offer you or equip you with? So let me start with this. Now, this course is designed to help you improve on your language skills. That is the cardinal thing about this course. To help you improve on your language skills. And when we talk about helping you to improve on your language skills, we're looking at your speaking skills, reading skills, and especially your writing skills. Okay? Because in the academia, in the university, your success largely depends on writing. Whatever department you belong to, whatever discipline, whatever course you are offering, you will be asked to write. You will be writing academic essays. You will be writing in the examinations. And you need to be equipped with the skills that you need to be able to do well or to write well in order to pass and then graduate successfully. So that is the broad aim of this course. So we'll be taking you through issues of who your audience are and sentence construction, issues of grammar, and how to form well, how to construct well-formed sentences, and then go beyond the sentence into paragraphs and putting paragraphs together into essays, chapters, and getting maybe a whole book, which is the ultimate requirement that students sometimes, when they are told at level 100, then they get stricken. What? I'm going to write a book of about 40 pages? How? We will go through that process, right? Great. So that is the broad aim of the course. Now, we're going to start with our opening lecture or the topic for today. And the topic for today is academic discourse. Academic discourse. So take note, academic discourse. So academic discourse one. Next week we'll come with academic discourse too. So, academic discourse. Let's start this way. For us to be able to understand what we mean by academic discourse, there is the need for us to situate it within a broad concept known as what is referred to as discourse communities. Discourse communities. Take note, discourse communities. So let's start this way. What is a discourse community? That will be too vast for us to respond to. So let's break it down, dear students. Let's pick it one after the other. Starting with what we are familiar with. What is a community? Can we respond to that? So you just try and write it down. What is a community? Okay? So I think by now you've been able to put something down. So a community, most people will say, is a group of people. A community is a group of people who share common goals. And these common goals may be values, ideas, a body of knowledge, norms, etc. And sometimes some people add, is a group of people who stay in a particular geographical area. But what is important is for us to note that a community is a group of people. And that group of people, they share common goals. They have something in common. It may be the language they speak, what they do, practices, norms, values, etc. Right? Great. That's fine. Now, if we have been able to define what a community is, then can we define or explain what discourse is? What is discourse? Yes. I believe by this time you have started Googling. That's the norm these days, and that's fine. With the internet, the moment you are not familiar with something, straight away, look for it. Yes. Great. I hope you are done. What did you find? What is discourse? Yes. So some of the things that you might have found from what you have Googled will be discourse is exchange of ideas. Exchange of ideas or conversation or a discussion or a debate, right? You have found things like this about what discourse is. So discourse, we can say, is a form of communication. So discourse is communication that comes with a kind of identity. Now, what do I mean by this? It comes with a kind of identity in such a way that when you have people engage in a particular conversation, you can trace that, oh, this conversation is akin to maybe a particular group of people, maybe medical profession, or is a medical discourse, or this one is, it will be lawyers who are talking because of the language they are using. So that kind of communication is what we refer to as discourse. So discourse is communication that has some kind of identity. So now let's put the two together. Now we know what a community is and we know what discourse is. Now let us all try our hands at this. Now let's put the two together. Now if a community is a group of people with common goals and discourse is communication, let's put the two together in order to explain what a discourse community is. So let everybody try to put something down as your attempt to explain what a discourse community is by putting the explanation of community and discourse together. Great. Have you been able to scribble something? Yep. That's good. Now let's look at what this term is or how it has been defined. This concept, discourse community, was proposed by a British linguist called John Swales in his 1990 writings. And John Swales defined, one of the definitions he offered is that a discourse community is a group of people with common goals who engage in communication to achieve those goals. That's the simplest definition. Right? Let me take it again. A group of people with common goals who engage in communication to achieve those goals. So you see, very simple. And is it very close to what you wrote down? Maybe. Thumbs up. That's great. So, a discourse community is a group of people with common goals. And that group of people, they engage in communication. And as they engage in communication, it helps them to achieve the goals that they have. Now, the issue of discourse communities is such that always, most of us belong to several different discourse communities. And because we belong to several different discourse communities, we talk to different people differently. Now, let's look at some examples and then the features of discourse communities. Then that will help us to be able to fully understand this concept of discourse communities. Right? Great. When we're looking at discourse communities, we said a group of people with common goals. And that common goal is usually a public goal. A public goal. A public goal in the sense that something that they do to serve the public. Right? So, examples of discourse communities range from what we call clubs. Societies. Do you belong to some clubs, societies, religious groups, professional groups, etc.? So if you take people who are lawyers, for example, they belong to the legal profession. So that constitutes a discourse community. If you have a group of health professionals, there is something that is common to them and they have a public goal, right? That constitutes a discourse community. And even religious groups constitute discourse communities. They have a public goal that they serve. Now, let us look at the features and that will help us to appreciate this concept better. Now, one of the features from our definition is that discourse communities have common goals. They have common goals. So, feature number one, discourse communities have common goal. There is something that they do, a body of knowledge that they engage in to serve the public interest. Two, and I would like you to take note of this. Discourse communities, to a large extent, develop what we call specific lexics. Specific lexics. So take note of that. Specific lexics. And what do we mean by specific lexics? When we talk about, okay, lexics is spelled L-E-X-I-S, right? Specific lexics. And this refers to expressions and terms or terminologies that are peculiar to that particular discourse community. So every discourse community to a large extent have some expressions that are peculiar to the members, some expressions with which they communicate among themselves, to the extent that if you are a lay person, you don't belong to that discourse community, you may not be able to understand them fully. Is that okay? Let's take, for example, those who are in the legal profession, the Bar Association, as a discourse community. When lawyers are engaged in a conversation, though you understand English, but you realize that the terms that they are using, you may not be familiar with that. These terms are specific lexis that we call legal expressions. The same thing applies to every discourse community. If you take those in the medical profession, like a medical doctor will tell you the person suffered from thrombosis. And as a lay person, you begin to wonder, thrombosis. In the layman's language, we call it heart attack, right? But they call it thrombosis. And a nurse will ask you, have they checked your vitals? And you begin to, what at all do they mean by this? Yes, that is the a medical term. Usually when you go to the hospital, before you see the doctor, they will take your temperature, I think your BP or something. Those things they take and record, your weight, before you see the doctor. That is what they call vitals. Do you get it? So the point here is that discourse communities, to a large extent, develop specific lexis, expressions that are peculiar to that, the members who belong to that discourse community. Is that okay? Great. So one, we have mentioned public goal. Two, they have specific lexis. Now, the third feature of discourse communities is that discourse communities have mechanisms of intercommunication among the members. Mechanisms of intercommunication. They have means by which they meet and share ideas. This may come in the form of seminars. It may come in the form of forum or fora. It may come in the form of meetings, right? So these mechanisms, sometimes it may not even be face-to-face meetings. They have to exchange maybe memos, writings, etc. among the members. So they have mechanisms of intercommunication. Then the third one related to, the fourth one related to point number three, is that discourse communities use the mechanisms of intercommunication to pass on information to their members and to receive feedback from their members. Is that okay? Great. So when they meet, maybe at a seminar, they share ideas. They pass on information about the body of knowledge that they have to their members. Sometimes an expert will take a turn to share ideas and receive feedback from the members. So we have mentioned four features, right? Public goal, two. Specific lenses, three. They have mechanisms of intercommunication, and four. They use the mechanisms of intercommunication to pass on information and receive feedback from their members. Is that okay? Okay, good. Now, the third feature, the fifth feature of discourse communities is that discourse communities use at least one or more genre. Genre is spelled G-E-N-R-E, right? G-E-N-R-E. That is what we call genre. Genre. Now, what do we mean by genre? Genre simply refers to a specific type of writing. Genre is a specific type of writing. So if we have, for example, application letters, and we collect all application letters, you realize that they will all have the same format, right? And almost same content. So we refer to all application letters as one genre. And the word genre is commonly used in literature. When they have poems, you know, poems are usually short, they rhyme, etc. So when we collect poems, we refer to that as a particular genre, poetry. And we have prose, it's a particular genre. So pieces of writing that have the same format are referred to as what we call genre. So now let's come to discourse communities utilizing genre. When you come to whatever discourse community that you take, for example, there is a particular form of writing that they use to share information, maybe among their members. So if you take, for example, let's take teachers, for example, as a discourse community, people involved in education, they make use of lesson notes. That is the means by which they practice their profession. So lesson notes belong to a particular genre, right? If you come to the medical profession, for example, they have prescriptions. It's a form of communication. So if you pick prescription, you send it to the doctor, he will be able to interpret it. You send it to the pharmacy, he will be able to interpret it. You send it to the nurse, he will be able to tell you what it is, what dosage, etc., etc. And most of the time, the way they even write, some of us laymen don't even, we are not able to read what they write. Do you get it? So that is a form of genre that is used in the medical profession. Is that okay? Good. The last or the sixth feature of discourse communities is that members of discourse communities acquire some level of knowledge and expertise. So most of the time, with all these discourse communities that we're talking about, professional groups or clubs or religious groups, etc., people who come into that discourse community, like you freshers level 100 that you have come now, you'll be novice. You will not know what to do, what, but with time you acquire skills and then you become experts at the end, right? So if somebody is offered admission to a medical school, that person will be fresh, he will be a novice, but after the 7 years of training, that person will become an expert and will be able to practice as a doctor. So even if you take a religious group, if they go on evangelism and some people surrender their lives to Jesus and they are baptized, they will be fresh people, they will be novices, they will not know the doctrines, they will not know the teachings, but as they are taken through, some of them will become experts and maybe become pastors and deacons, etc., as they grow in the church. Is that okay? So for every discourse community that we join, we may start as novice but gradually acquire knowledge and become experts in the field, right? Great. Now, why are we talking about discourse communities, my dear students? We have explained the features or the characteristics of discourse communities, and we have given some examples of discourse communities. Now, our focus is on academic discourse. Now, what then do we mean by academic discourse? Now, let's come to our point now. What we have said so far, my dear students, will you agree with me that the university can also be referred to as a discourse community? Can we say the university is also a discourse community of its own? Sure. Exactly. So the university as a discourse community is what we refer to as the academic discourse community. The academic discourse community. And the academic discourse community refers to the university. And the university as a discourse community, what goes on here is academic discourse. Now, somebody will ask, does the university, does it have all the features that I just mentioned? Let's start. Does it have a common goal? Sure. The universities have a common goal. And what is that common goal? That common goal is to create or generate knowledge and share knowledge. So the university share knowledge. They impart knowledge. And sometimes I ask students, where do they get the knowledge from? And some will tell you they get the knowledge from books. Then I said, okay, fine. Now, those who wrote the books, where do they get the knowledge from? So you realize that those who write the book, they get the knowledge from research and experience, right? So that is the basic goal of the university, to carry out research and to generate knowledge and impart knowledge. So the universities have a common public goal. Then point number two, when you come to the university, can we say we have specific lenses Do we have specific lenses, expressions, and terms that are peculiar to the investing community? Sure. Since you entered, you realize that. We talk about registration of courses. We talk about course outlines. We talk about credit hours, right? We understand what we mean by credit hours in the investing community, in university discourse. If you go to the market and ask a tomato seller, how many credit hours are you offering? That will be meaningless to her. But here on campus, if I ask you, this semester, how many credit hours are you doing? You'll be able to tell me 18 or 21. Then I will say, oh, your credit hours are loaded or not loaded. Is that right? Yes. So the university community, we have specific lexes. And even sometimes in the university community, some people will tell you, yes, it is a large discourse community with several smaller discourse communities, referring to the various departments as smaller discourse communities within the bigger discourse community. So if you take mathematics, for example, mathematics can be a discourse community within the university. Because when you go to mathematics, even the terminologies they use will be different from when you go to applied linguistics. And that will be different from when you go to art education, right? Great. So all these constitute smaller discourse communities within the university discourse community. Is that okay? Great. So we can go on and see that all the features that we discussed, the university has all those features, and that qualifies the university to be a discourse community. And that is why we are talking about academic discourse, right? Great. When it comes to mechanisms of intercommunication among members, yes, we have lectures, we have seminars, we have conferences, various means by which we meet and share knowledge about the various subject areas. Is that okay? Great. Now, academic discourse, an important part of academic discourse is what we call academic writing. I have already said that the broad goal of the university is to carry out research, get knowledge, write, and impart this knowledge to students and to the larger public. Great. Now, in generating the knowledge and imparting the knowledge, it comes with writing. And that kind of writing that goes on in the academia, the university is what we call the academia. That kind of writing, that kind of discourse that goes on in the academia is what we refer to as academic writing. And academic writing manifests in various forms. We'll look at some examples. And this kind of writing is usually about research. So an experiment is carried out, then you have to write the findings. So you realize that all the various disciplines that you belong to, you will be asked to carry out some kind of research, maybe to interview people or to do experiments, to carry out projects, and you have to write the report. Yes. And sometimes you'll be asked to write essays. All these pieces of writing are academic writings. And academic writings have certain features. One striking feature of academic writing is that academic writings are done by consulting multiple sources. That is one thing about academic writing. When you just don't get up and write, but you need to read widely and know what exists before you even carry out your research and know what you are contributing to that topic. So you first have to consult several books, etc., in the field. So consulting, so we usually say that academic writing is that type of writing that is done by consulting multiple sources. And one of the features is that multiple sources are consulted and cited in the essay or the report that you write. Then the next thing, which is very important, that I would like you to take note of is that the sources that are cited in academic writings they are acknowledged. Very important. What do we mean by they are acknowledged? When you consult a particular source and you get a piece of idea from that source and use it in your writing, you need to indicate where you got that piece of information from. That is what we call acknowledgement. And in the academia, failure to acknowledge the source from which you get your information becomes an offense known as what? Plagiarism. Plagiarism. So plagiarism is for you to steal, let me use the word steal, information from somebody. But if you fail to acknowledge it, then you are stealing it. But if you get the information and you are able to indicate that, oh, it is according to Aqua 2018, then we know it is a book that maybe Aqua wrote in 2018. So that knowledge is from Aqua, right? Great. But if you just get the book, you copy the information without indicating that you got it from Aqua, that is the author of the book, then you are committing a serious offense in the academia known as what? Plagiarism. Okay? Great. Another feature of academic writing is that the language that is used in academic writing is formal. The language is formal. It is devoid of contracted forms. Contracted forms, things we use like can't. It's using no, and slang language, no, official, that's, it is formal. Then also in academic writing, one feature of academic writing is that passive voice is preferred. Sometimes when we say passive voice, some students would just say, hey, passive voice is preferred. But what do we mean by passive voice? Passive voice or passive sentence, that is where you need to go through communication skills as a course to know how to construct your sentences. So passive voice, we have passive voice and we have active voice. Active voice is where you project yourself or the doer of the action. So I can say, for example, I collected data from three sources. That is active. But in academic writing, it is preferred that you write it in passive voice, where you hide the doer. So data were collected from three sources. Data were collected from three sources. That is a passive construction. But active is, I collected data from three sources. Do you get it? So you can write, for example, I found that, yes, that is active, but it is preferred that you write it in passive by, it was found that 20% of this results in this or that. Is that okay? So that it becomes what we call impersonal. You are not projecting person into your writing. Especially for the sciences, they insist on impersonal language and the use of passive voice. Okay? Great. So these are things that we'll be discussing in details. Maybe in our face-to-face, we'll practice how to write the sentences, how to write from active to passive, etc. Is that okay? Great. Good. And academic writing, usually it has a defined structure, an introduction, a body, and a conclusion. Now, one of the types of academic writing that you will be using often as practice is what you call the academic essay. You will be asked to write essays. So the essay is, I would say, the shorter form of academic writing. An academic essay is different from a fictional essay. You know fiction. The word fiction means not real, not fact, right? That kind of essay that you'll be asked, oh, write about an interesting place that you visited during the last vacation. And though you did not visit any place, you'll be able to write that essay based on imagination. Do you get it? That is a fictional essay. But academic essay is different. Academic essay is based on academic topics, on facts, on events that had happened, like experiments, and we write the reports of them. Is that okay? Great. And fictional essay is usually based on fantasies, imaginations, and exaggerations using colorful language. But academic writing is not, but you write formal language, right? Great. Yes. Maybe we can start. Can we start with the calls at this juncture? Okay. Great. The numbers to call: 0503-923158 or 0332-320201. And please kindly reduce the volume and move away. Reduce the volume of your set and move away, or move away from your radio set, so that we will not get feedback. Okay? Great. All right. So for, okay, a caller on the line. Hello. Hello. When you call, please tell us your name and maybe the department, and that will be fine.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, please.
Your name and department, please. Oh. We have lost the caller. Please, the number once again: 0503-923158 or 0332-320201.
Hello.
Hello.
No, good morning.
Good morning. Lower the volume because we are getting feedback.
Hello.
Hello.
No, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, my name is Richard from the English department.
All right. Go ahead.
Hello, Doc.
Yeah, go ahead.
Please. I was listening to you whilst I write, and then I had a little challenge the way you are giving us the lesson. Please, you are going a bit faster. So, please, you can be repeating, maybe when you give us the definition of a term, you can repeat it for us so that we get a concept for it.
Okay, all right. Okay, thank you. So we've taken notice of that. But, well, we'll come to that. Maybe you're trying to write everything that I said. That's why your rate of writing is quite slow. But we'll still take our time to let you get it. Hello.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Please, finishing about the academic writing or essay.
Yes.
I think the difference is between the fictional essay and academic essay.
We can't hear you. Can you speak up a little? And maybe switch off.
You gave a definition to differentiate between the fiction essay or the fiction writing and the academic writing.
Yes.
You said the fiction was about imagination,
right? Yes, please.
Academic also deals with what is real, let's say factual actions. I wanted to know if there are other differences, or we should go with just this definition that you've given, the differentiating among them.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Yes, there are other differences. I talk about the language used too. And, okay.
Hello.
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 Hello. Your name and your
good
department.
Good morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Please, this is Regina from Home Economics Department.
All right.
Please, my question is, can you describe the family as a discourse community? If yes, please explain a little. If no, explain a little too. Thank you, sir.
Okay. A family as a discourse community. Okay. Yes, to some extent, we can refer to a family as a discourse community. It will have some of the characteristics or features of a discourse community. A family has unique or specific lenses. The things that you talk about in your family will be different from the things that we talk about or the things that are of concern to my family. So the families will not be the same, they will be unique. Then in addition to that, families have mechanisms of intercommunication, right, among their members. And the mechanisms of intercommunication may be Easter meetings, Christmas gatherings, etc. Or sometimes some families even have specific meeting times, right, etc. So yes, to a large extent, the family can also constitute a discourse community of its own. Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Dr. from English Department.
Okay.
Yes, as the teachers of academic discourse, I would like to ask a question on short acknowledgement. I want to know if yourself is not a formal source, is an informal source, you need to acknowledge the source or not.
What do you mean by informal source?
Can you give maybe a source that is not written. Maybe you ask questions from people and they give information during your research.
Okay, I see. Great.
I like you.
Yeah, thank you. Great. If your source is not published, so in academia we talk about a source that is published. Now if the source is published, then that one, it exists as a document that we can refer to, right? As a book, as a journal, as a magazine, as an article, as proceedings, do you get it? Or even online, then it is a source we can refer to. Now if it is not published, for example, you said from a conversation, you engage in a conversation with somebody and the person gives you a piece of idea and you decide to use that idea in your writing. Yes, you can still acknowledge it. You can acknowledge it that it is from a conversation with so-so and so person. That is honesty. In fact, the academia deals with honesty. They don't want you to be dishonest. That's the source of it. But it becomes a bit problematic if you want to acknowledge something like a conversation on radio. If it is a conversation on radio and you are using it, you know, people can deny. So the best thing is to record it. If you are able to record that radio conversation, then you can actually cite it and acknowledge it. Great. Okay. Yes, the numbers 0503-923-158
or 0332-320201.
A caller on the line. Okay, let's... Hello.
Hello. Good morning. Good morning,
sir.
Please, I'm calling from
Okay.
I wanted to find out what are the types of academic writing. Is it only one or you give us more of the type?
The what?
The types of academic writing.
Okay, the types. Okay, the types or examples of academic writing. The types or examples of academic writing. We have the academic essay. We have reports. We have long essays. We have theses. We have dissertations. We have journal articles. Yes, All these are examples of academic writing, and we'll look at what these are in details. Long essays and project works usually produced by students at the first degree level. Then we have the dissertation and thesis at the master's level. We have the journal articles, that is academic paper that you write, and it has broader readership. Then we have the academic essays, which we usually use to test students. So we have all these as examples of academic writings or types of academic writing. Great. A caller on the line.
Hello, please. Good morning. My name is Abigail from Special Education.
Good morning, Abigail.
Hello.
Hello, I can hear you.
Okay, I want the difference between passive voice and active voice.
Okay, writing in a passive construction and writing in an active construction. Usually children are good at this. When you leave the house and come back and they've done something wrong, for example, they will tell you the glass was broken. But who broke the glass? That one they won't tell you. And if you probe further, they will tell you it broke by itself. That is a passive construction. So the glass was broken. It's passive. Now, they know the person who broke the glass, all right, but they don't want to mention the person. So if you want to make the sentence active, then you say Kofi broke the glass. But they don't want to tell you it is Kofi, so they will tell you the glass was broken. Right? Great. That is a passive voice. So a passive voice or passive sentence is just a sentence that I would say the person who did the thing is usually not mentioned. But the action is highlighted. Do you get it? Yes. Great. So what we said is that in writing academic reports, especially you are talking about your findings or your methodology that you use, it is preferred, especially in scientific language, in the sciences, that let it be passive, let it be impersonal. So I gave examples like data were collected from three sources instead of I collected data from three sources, right? I found that so and so. Why not hide yourself? So you say it was found that, right? That's passive construction. Is that okay? Great. I hope it is now well understood. A caller on the line.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please, my name is Gwati Michael from the Science Department.
Okay.
Yeah, please. I want to know the actual definition for academic discourse.
Actual definition for
academic discourse.
Academic discourse. Okay, thank you. All right. Thank you. Now, you want definition. Academic discourse is the kind of interaction that goes on in the academia. Academic discourse is that kind of discourse or interaction or exchange of ideas that takes place in the university community. That is academic discourse. Do you get it? And this, what we're referring to as academic discourse, include what happens at lectures, seminars, our presentations, and in the writing of our essays and long essays, project works, dissertations, and theses. All of these things that are concerned with what the goal is, to generate knowledge through research and disseminate this knowledge, is academic discourse. Do you get it right? Yes, all these constitute academic discourse. And I remember I said that a larger portion of academic discourse has to do with academic writing. Academic writing. Your essays, your academic essays. These are the means by which the exchange or ideas are exchanged in the academia. Every discipline, they carry out research and they publish their research work. and they do presentations, etc. Okay. Some people are on Facebook. Questions for us? Wow, Radio Windy Bay, doing great. Okay, this is Danny Khalifa, Asamoah Daniel from Biology Department. Mr. Please, you said you don't have to bring in personification example in data was collected from, I collected data. So please, if I conclude something like that in my writing, does it make all my essay wrong? Okay. It doesn't make all your essay wrong, but just that you are not using the right style. You are not using the preferred style. Do you get it? Not that it is wrong. So you need to know the style that is suitable for your discipline or for your department so that you use the appropriate style. Else you'll be asked to go and change it. Do you get it? Uh-huh. Please, you did define academic discourse. Oh, yes, I did. Academic discourse, that's the exchange of ideas, interactions that go on in the university community, right? Which includes academic writing. Then another, Frimpong. Okay, that is from Apia. Now, Frimpong, please, does academic writing require formal essay writing? Frimpong Mark, yes, from History Department, yes. The language of academic writing is formal. No contracted forms, no slangs, no text message language. Formal expressions. Is that okay? And even we don't use exaggerations in academic. We don't use proverbs. Like somebody said, oh, this company, they work like bulls. How do bulls work? It's difficult to interpret proverbs. So just say they work from 6 to 6. Specific academic writing prefers things that are accurate, things that are objective, right? And not proverbs and exaggerations, etc. Great. The next one, Asamoah Daniel, please, you said you have to consult and get a source of data before concluding or write a report. And I want to ask that, can I just write what I know or what I saw without doing any consultation? Then that will not be an academic paper. That is plain writing. It is not academic writing. Academic writing is the type of writing that is done by consulting multiple sources. And why do you have to consult multiple sources? We'll look at these details in the face-to-face lecture. You have to consult multiple sources because how will you even know that this thing already exists? For example, in research, you are carrying out research on malaria, how to cure malaria. You need to know the previous malaria drugs and the problems with them before you can develop a new one. You can't develop a new one out of the blue. So that when you develop a new one, you can now link it to where the research started from and where it got to and how you've been able to arrive at the new one. That is the academia. You need to build on existing knowledge. Do you get it? That is why it becomes necessary for us to consult sources. Else, you just write something and then they will tell you, oh, this thing exists already. We know it already. So why are you telling us? Archimedes has already told us this. So you have to start from where Archimedes ended. Great. So you can't write an academic essay. Okay, a caller on the line. Let's take the call.
Good morning.
Yeah, good morning.
That's Love from Special Education.
All right.
We define discourse community by a professor. May I please know the name again?
Oh, okay. I mentioned John Swales. John Swales. John Swales. Swales.
Okay, thank you.
John Swales, a British linguist. John Swales is a popular writer, so you can Google, you'll find John Swales writing. Hello, a caller.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning. My name is Abraham Kui, from the business department.
Okay.
we have disadvantages of plagiarism.
Disadvantages of what?
Plagiarism.
Wow. Disadvantages, you mean? In fact, plagiarism is an offense and it comes with serious sanctions. And one of the sanctions is for you to be dismissed from the university. Outright dismissal. If you plagiarize, yes, that is the sanction. And even when you plagiarize and it is not noticed and you have completed the university, you submitted your thesis, then 5 years later it is found that you actually plagiarize, you will be dismissed. Your certificate will be withdrawn. Yes, so these are the disadvantages, if you want to call them so, but they are sanctions, right? Then there is a question here. I didn't mention the documentation styles. There's a question I want to fetch over here. There was somebody. Yes, when I mentioned, there's a caller. Let's take the call before we go back to the text messages. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
We'll be able to respond.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Please, my name is Akunya.
Okay.
From the science department.
All right. There's feedback. Please go ahead. We can hardly hear you. If you can speak up a little or move away from your radio so that we will not get a feedback. Speak up a little. Oh. It's off. Okay. Oh, too bad. Oh, please try and call again. We keep. Okay. Now, let's respond to those who have sent us messages. I am Edu Rahel, blessed from special education. According to Scribendi, I or we is not used in academic writing. Is it because passive voice is used in academic writing? Yes, the I and the we is person. You project yourself. So, yes, you have found that this is not used. It is not preferred for you to be using we. So, when you use passive construction, then you avoid the we. Do you get it? And the I, and the he, and the she. All the nouns and the pronouns will not be there. Please explain the meaning of the word Jean. Jean refers to a particular type of writing. So, all types of writing belong to what we call Jean. So, if you pick letters, as I gave, that is a Jean. If you pick poems, that they all belong to a particular Jean, etc. Okay, a caller on the line. Yes, let's pick the call.
Hello, this is Dial Aldo calling from Mathematics Education.
Lower the volume on your set so that we don't get feedback.
Okay. I'm trying to ask that, can academic ethics be in functional ethics? Well, functional ethics can't be in academic essay. I just want to find out.
Your question again.
I'm asking.
Yes.
If academic essay can be in functional essay.
Well,
it can be in academic essay.
Well, academic essay is an academic essay. A fictional essay is fictional. Now, we can have some fictional writing that may be factual, fine. But academic writing is unique in the sense that in academic writing, you have to consult sources and use the sources to support your claims or what you write. So that is unique about academic writing. We use sources to support claims, etc. But that is not required in a fictional essay or fictional writing. Is that okay? Great. We are missing this one. We have a number of messages received that we are not able to respond to here. let's take some of them quickly. I'm Philip, a member of mathematics department. In fact, you have done a great work for us. May God richly bless you. Please, I want to ask, aside the radio lecture, when and where will we meet for the face-to-face? Oh, that one, consult your departmental timetable. The timetable is there. The lecturer is ready to meet you. And don't worry, you will meet for the face-to-face. Consult the timetable. See your exam officer. He will tell you the time for the face-to-face. Good morning, sir. I'm Muhammad Harun from business. It says discourse can include anything from listening to debating, presentation to metacognition and even writing. Yes, discourse include all these things. And all these things are forms of communication or exchange of ideas. Please, my name is Mensa Moses from History Department. I want to ask that, is church an example of a discourse community? Yes, a church is an example. Religious groupings are examples of discourse communities because they have common goals, they have mechanisms of intercommunication, and they have specific genre, right? Yes, they have even specific lexics. When you enter the church, sometimes even the way they call people, somebody is prophet this, brother this, sister that. That is how they address one another. But if you come to the classroom and you start calling people Sister Joan, prophet this, that will be odd. So that discourse is peculiar to the church community, right? Great. Please, Pascaline from the linguistic department, please, can you repeat the definition of a discourse community? A discourse community, as I refer to John Swales, is that it's a group of people with common goals who engage in communication to achieve their goals. Is that okay? Great. Okay, I think we've taken all the messages so that we'll not leave them. Okay, there's a question. I couldn't get a person that's asking about APA. Yes, I didn't mention APA. Now, I talk about acknowledgement of the sources. Now, the sources are acknowledged using what we call referencing styles or documentation styles. And the referencing styles that are used to acknowledge the sources, there are several types of them. We have one of them is the APA style. We have the MLA style. We have the Vancouver style. We have the Harvard style, etc., etc. So the one that we are going to focus on is the APA style. How the APA style is used to acknowledge the sources that you consult and mention in your academic essay. Great. So that is a whole topic that we'll be dealing with.
Yeah.
Documentation. Yeah, so we'll come to it in details. I think that will be our last lecture. Great. Sir, please, you didn't tackle my... Oh, which question is that? You didn't... there's somebody asking. You didn't tackle my question, please. Oh, and he didn't repeat the question. I have not been able to get a question. He only said I didn't tackle his question. And what is his question? What's the name? Mohammed. Oh, sorry, I'm not able to get your question. But you said I didn't tackle your question. Maybe if you can quickly send your question again. Yes, if you can quickly send your question again or call. Please, Adam is my name from the Art Education Department. Please, my question, what are the kinds of mechanisms used to communicate in the discourse community? Yes, mechanisms of intercommunication among members can be in the form of meetings. It can be in the form of lectures. It can be in the form of seminars. It can be in the form of conferences, right? It can be in the form of memos. These are all mechanisms of intercommunication among members of a discourse community. Great. Good morning, sir. I'm Madia from the Home Economics Department. I want to know if there is total number of people with a common goal that is required to be called a discourse community. No. We can't talk about a total number. Discourse communities grow. People go on retirement, new people join it. Some die, some are born into it. And if two individuals with a common goal can be seen as a discourse community, two individuals, then they'll form a company or an enterprise, but not a discourse community per se. Okay, a caller, kindly come again on the nature of academic communication. Okay, let's take the call, then we'll respond to. Hello. Hello.
Please, I'm Norbert from Physical Education Research Department.
Okay.
I would like to ask whether we can classify market as a dispute community.
Okay, a market. Yeah. Yes, well, even a market, we can have several discourse communities among, we can have those who are in the GPRT, you constitute a discourse community, maybe the Maize Sellers Association, the Tomato Sellers Association, and you know these people meet and they have issues that are of concern to them and issues that they discuss among themselves, and they also have a public goal. A public goal is maybe to make the maize available for you and for me to go and buy, right? Yes, so we will classify them as discourse communities of their own, because all clubs, all associations, so you see, even the former clubs that you have, like Red Cross Society, Lions Club, and what are some of the examples, all these are examples of discourse communities, because the members have specific legs with which they communicate among themselves and a body of knowledge that is of concern to them. The word genre is also in science, in classification of organisms. That's great. So tell us about the classification of organisms that is referred to as genre. Cephas, tell us. Cephas Asim. Okay, Muhammad from business department. I said this course can include any. Oh, okay, we've looked at this message. Please, Holali from the department of sorry if we are not able to respond to all your calls and all your messages. It looks like we are overwhelmed by the messages that are coming. Have I read this one? Oh, we missed that of Holali from. Can you please, okay, Holali, can you please spell the
what,
plagiarism? Plagiarism. 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 PLA. Right? Plagiarism. Okay? Great. Plagiarism. Good morning. Eva from History Department, I want to know if an examination room is a discourse community. Not the examination room as a discourse community, but the examination is part of academic discourse, right? The examination room is part of academic discourse. The lecture hall is part of academic discourse. The seminar is part of academic discourse. The conferences, the writings are all part of academic discourse. Is that okay? Great. Good morning, sir. My name is Elom from the History Department. Please, my question is, can a town be called a discourse community? That would be a very big discourse community. But yes, a town, discourse communities, we can have discourse communities within discourse communities. Yes. So a town can be, because it will have concerns, or it will have things that are of concern to them, right? Great. I am Muhammad. Discourse. Okay, we look at this.
So I think the messages are now finished.
Okay, so we've been able to go through all the messages. Great. That's Elom. We've responded to Elom. Muhammad. Please, what is the full meaning of APA? Great. Yes.
Yes, student, that's
APA.
Ebenezer.
Yeah.
APA is American Psychological Association.
Yes.
And it is one of the references style, which I believe your lecturer will deal with it so detailed in your face-to-face lectures. So that is American Psychological Association. It's a referencing style.
Yes. Yes, that's it. So you got it right, Prince? My question is not answered. Oh, please, if you are sending the message, just send the question again so that we will be able to get it, because we are not able to trace it. Oh, Prince, check if you can send it.
Check my question.
Prince, my question is not answered. Sorry about that, but if you can quickly send it, because we'll be signing off in the next minute or so. Kwesi Mary, Home Economics, Church. Yes, the church is an example of a discourse community. Yeah, we have said that one. Please, you didn't read my message. Oh, Mami Ama, if you can quickly send it.
Or call.
If you can quickly send it or call, we'll be able to get it. Okay, there's a call. A caller on the line. Yes, please.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning.
Yes, good morning.
I'm Godfrey Kosuke Tesin, calling from Chinese Department.
Speak up a little so that we can hear you.
I'm Godfrey Kosuke Tesin.
Okay, go ahead.
My question is about the academic issues and then academic writing. You said that I made academic writing, and the example is academic issues.
Yes.
And for academic issues, you give an example like previous examination, project work, and other stuff.
Yes.
So, what I'm confused is, I think both are related. So, indirectly, can we say that, can we refer academic issues as academic writing? So, that would be coming out with any differences.
Okay, broadly, they are all academic writings. They are all academic writings. Academic writings have unique features broadly. Now, an academic writing can be an essay. If it is an essay, we call it an academic essay, right? An academic writing can be a paper, what we call an article. Then we can have an academic writing which is very long and it is a project work. And we can also have an academic writing which is a thesis or a dissertation. So they are all academic writings or examples or types of academic writings. So an academic essay is one of the examples of academic writings. Is that okay? Yes. Please say, I am Hillary. In fact, may the Lord Almighty give you long life. But please, can I get the definition of discourse community again? Because you said discourse community is a group of people having common goal. And you stated the example as the church, please. Banking sector, can banking sector be one of them? Like people in the banking sector, okay, and business as a whole. Yes, discourse community is a group of people with common goals who engage in communication to achieve those goals. Yes. So yes, the banking sector or people in the business, we also have business language and business expressions. Okay, sorry, there is a call. Let's pick the call. Hello. Okay. Okay. Maybe we have been given extension. Okay, we should have closed at 7:30. It is past 8 and we are still receiving calls. 0503-923158 or 0332-320201. These are the numbers once again. A caller on the line.
Hello.
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 Yeah, go ahead, please. Your name and your department.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Chris, I'm Selena. Hello.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Chris, I'm Selena from the business department.
Okay.
I'm Selena.
Yes, please. Yeah, Selena, go ahead.
Yes. Chris, I wanted to ask that, so in examination, I want to use only passive voice, or is it that active voice is not allowed in examination?
Okay, thank you. Yes, sometimes when we talk about academic writing and we look at the features, then some people say, hey, then it means in the examination too, do I have to cite the sources? Please, no. In the examination, you are not expected to even send any book, so you can't cite from any source. So examination condition, what we write under examination condition is something that should come from you, something you have read, something that you have analyzed, and you'll be able to produce it on paper. But academic writing is the writing that is done as a homework. Sometimes you have a whole month and you consult the books, you look at the books and copy the sentence from it and acknowledge the author's name, the year in which it was published, etc. You don't have that luxury in the examination. So please know. Okay? Great. A caller on the line. Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Hello? Speak up a little.
Hello?
Hello, speak up a little. Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Hello?
Yeah, hello, go ahead.
Hi there.
Yes, please, go ahead.
I'm Godfrey from English Department.
Okay.
Please, can one represent his ideas in their writing, in academic writing? Can
sure.
one decide to represent his ideas in it?
Yes. In academic writing, you can project your ideas and your opinion. Now, your ideas and your opinion sometimes may be informed by what you have read. Based on what you have read, you can refer to what you have read, and based on that, you feel it is this, or your opinion is that it should be that. Do you get the point? Yes. In academic essays, students are allowed to express their ideas and their opinion, but these are usually anchored in what we call the literature. Is that okay? That's great. A caller. Hello.
Please, good morning. My name is Akavika.
Please speak up a little. Your voice is quite faint.
It's Batman. Hello.
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 Yeah, please go ahead.
You thought John Swartz, but my frequency was disturbing me, so please, I couldn't hear it well. So if you could repeat it for me, please.
Yeah, the name of the person who proposed the concept of a discourse community is John Swales. John, then Swales, Swales, John Swales. Right. Okay, you got it now. Thank you. What is the meaning of specific lexis? Specific lexis simply refers to the expressions or the terminologies that are used by a particular group of people. Hello.
Hello.
We have
good morning.
Good morning. Please lower the volume on your side.
Good morning.
Yes, good morning. Please go ahead.
My name is Petunia from Home Economics Department.
Okay.
I was Petunia from Home Economics Department.
Let's go ahead.
I want to know about plagiarism.
Okay, plagiarism. Okay. Yes. Plagiarism has to do with
which you are using to answer your question.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Now, in the exam hall, when you are writing, you're answering a particular question. You are not expected to cite the source. That this information, it is entry 2018 states that so and so. No. But when you are writing your academic essay, when you are writing your project work, your long essay, etc., you need to do this to avoid plagiarism. You see, plagiarism usually has to do with what we call, it's an issue of authorship. Author. You are claiming that you are the author of something. So if you are the author of that thing, then you should own it. But if you don't own it, tell us who the author is. That is the issue of plagiarism. But in the examination, you are usually asked to explain concepts. Is that okay? Great. So you are not expected to cite sources and the examination condition. But if you can do, then that's a credit to you. Okay. Please, the features of a discourse community. Okay, we've mentioned that over and over. I love the presentation, very clear and understandable. Well, from management department, this is okay. That's Malaika Elomi. Wow, I've not seen this name before. Okay, Sky. Wells from the management department, can the World Health Organization be classified as a discourse community? Well, we have the health professionals, so all health professionals, right? So the health professionals may have some organizations, association. So if you come to the academia too, we have groupings within the academia, right? Great. Have we missed something? Okay. I think we've been able to respond to the messages as well. So, but let me say, we are very sorry if we are not able to mention your name or respond to your question. That should not discourage you. Please, we are sorry. It came to a point that we were receiving tons and tons of messages. So it could be that we lost track of some of them. Sorry about that. And please, just tune in. Will come your way again next week. So thank you for today. Now, a summary of what we have done for today. Today we look at academic discourse, and we look at what a discourse community is, that it is a group of people with common goals who engage in communication to achieve their goals. We look at the examples of discourse communities, and we went on to look at the features that discourse communities have. Common goals, they have specific lenses, they have mechanisms of intercommunication, and they have or they use specific genre. Great. Then we also look at what is important to us, academic discourse and the academic discourse community. And we had a little focus on academic writing and the features of academic writing and how academic writing is different from fictional writing. Is that okay? Great. So briefly, that is what we have discussed today. Thank you so much for listening. So on this note, we are going to sign off. This is your lecturer, Albert Agbesi Wonyo, and my colleague,
Isaac Kwajo Nsonwa Apa.
Great. So on this note, we say, enjoy your weekend. Bye for now.
So that is it for you right here, 98.3 FM. Like the wise of old do say, if this is the beginning, you just can imagine how